This is a video which is distributed at the 16th International Workshop on Real and Complex Singularities in November 2020. My name is Klaus Hertling. I will report on joint work with Makiko Maase on the integral monodromy of isolated quasi-homogeneous singularities. I will report on two papers which we put in September this year on the archive. The first has 38 pages. It contains topological results on the psychotype singularities. It has the title The Integral Monodromy of the Psychotype Singularities. The second paper has 84 pages. It is on the integral monodromy of all isolated quasi-homogeneous singularities. But in fact, it contains mainly algebraic results and at the end applies them to the singularities. So the next slide is one slide on the history of the subjects. Afterwards, I will present 8 slides with algebraic definitions and results from the longer paper. Then I will recall in 4 slides facts, classical facts on isolated quasi-homogeneous hypersurface singularities. And finally, I come to the application of the algebraic results to the quasi-homogeneous singularities. So Peter Orlik in 1972 proposed a conjecture which says roughly that the integral monodromy on the Milner lattice of an isolated quasi-homogeneous hypersurface singularity takes the simplest possible shape. I will formulate this conjecture precisely later. So in September this year, in the 2 papers on the archive, we prove this conjecture for all iterated Tom Sebastiani sums of chain-type singularities and psychotype singularities. These are the so-called invertible polynomials. And this result surpasses all the known cases. So we could build on earlier work of Orlik and Randell from 77. They proved a result on the monodromy for the chain-type singularities. We could also build on a paper of Cooper from 1982, where he considered the integral monodromy on the psychotype singularities. We could build on it and we could correct it because there were 2 serious mistakes in the paper. And this is our first paper of topological flair. And finally, 1986, Michel and Weber proved Orlik's conjecture in the case of 2 variables in the curve case. So now I come to the algebra, which is in our longer paper. So big H will in the whole talk denote a Z lattice of a finite rank N. And small h will always be an automorphism of this Z lattice, which we usually will call monodromy. And P index small h will be the characteristic polynomial of this automorphism. It is a unitary polynomial with integer coefficients. So such a pair of a Z lattice at an automorphism is called a companion block if there exists a cyclic generator. That means there should exist an vector E0 in big H such that E0 and its images under the powers of the monodromy form a Z basis of the whole lattice. And then the matrix of the monodromy with respect to the Z basis is the companion matrix for this characteristic polynomial, which everybody knows from linear algebra. So, and of course here, the pair of lattice and automorphism up to isomorphism are uniquely determined by the characteristic polynomial. So therefore the following notation is justified. So h upper index ph in square brackets denotes such a companion block for a given characteristic polynomial. And also everybody knows that in this situation then the automorphism has for each eigenvalue only 1 Jordan block. So we care in this talk about the special case of companion blocks. Such a pair of Z lattice H and automorphism small h is called an Orlik block if it is a companion block and if the characteristic polynomial is just the product of cyclotomic polynomials, where each of them has only multiplicity 1. And then, in fact, then this holds if and only if the automorphism has finite order. And then we have the finite set big M of all the orders of the eigenvalues of this automorphism. And this is a finite set of natural numbers and it determines then the pair up to isomorphism. So, in general, we do not only have one ordinary block, but we have a general pair of an lattice and automorphism. And we say that it allows a decomposition into companion blocks or Ohlig blocks if it is isomorphic to a direct sum of companion blocks or Ohlig blocks for suitable unitary polynomials with integer coefficients. And yeah, the best case is the case when this such a decomposition is the standard decomposition, and that holds by definition if the polynomials satisfy that P1 is the largest, PL is the smallest one, and PL divides PL minus 1, which divides PL minus 2, and so on, and P2 divides P1. And in that case, these polynomials are uniquely determined by the characteristic polynomial PH. So this is the best possible case, the standard decomposition into companion blocks or Ohlig blocks. Now I present some results. First, there is a kind of Chinese remainder theorem for companion blocks. And here I have two parts in the theorem. The first is probably classical, although I don't know a reference. Let us start with two unitary polynomials with integer coefficients. Then the companion block for the product of them is isomorphic to the direct sum of the companion blocks for the first and the second one, if and only if the resultant is plus minus one. And the second part compares two different direct sums of two Ohlig blocks. Here we start with four unitary polynomials with integer coefficients, f1, f2, f3, f4, such that they have no common factor. And then it turns out that the sums of Ohlig blocks, which you see on the left and right hand side, are isomorphic if and only if the resultants of f1, f4 is plus minus 1, and the resultants of f2, f4 is plus minus 1. And if you compare the two direct sums of companion blocks, you see that only f4 is shifted from the left block on the left-hand side to the right block on the right-hand side. So this is not a difficult result. The proof is short and easy. One just has to deal with these resultants in an appropriate way. The next result is much more difficult, and it's more closer to our singularity case. So here we start with one Ohlig block, that is big H, automorphism small h. And then we know the characteristic polynomial is the product of cyclotopic polynomials, and the set big M of natural numbers is the set of orders of the eigenvalues. And now we consider the power of this automorphism, and we consider the pair of lattice with this power and ask, when does it allow a standard decomposition into Ohlig blocks? And we have a sufficient condition, which is of a combinatorial type, and I don't have enough time to give it in detail, it's too complicated. So there is a condition on this set M and the additional number mu, natural number mu, which I call SDIOB sufficient. And this is sufficient for a standard decomposition into Ohlig blocks. We expect that it's also necessary, but we do not have proof for that conjecture. But sufficiency is the important case, and that we know. And this will be applied later to the case of the chain type singularities. So the next result is probably the most difficult result and has the longest proof in the whole paper, in the long paper. Here we start with two Ohlig blocks, lattice big G automorphism small g and lattice big H automorphism small h. And the sets of orders of eigenvalues of these two automorphisms are called big N and big M. And again we ask, when does the tensor product of the lattices and with the tensor product of the automorphisms allow a standard decomposition into Ohlig blocks? And again, we have a sufficient condition. It's again a complicated combinatorial condition on this pair of natural numbers, N and M, which I cannot present in this talk, it's too complicated. But it's a precise condition, and we know it's sufficient, and again, we expect it's also necessary. So let me stress again that the proof of this result is long and very hard. We have to do a lot of calculations, essentially elementary, but it's quite a lot to do. So, but this theorem is just a step towards the next theorem, which we will apply in the singularity case. This is a Tom Sebastiani type result. So here we start with two lattices with automorphisms, big G small g and big H small h, such that both of them allow standard decompositions into Orlik blocks. And we ask, when does the tensor product of them again allow a standard decomposition into Orlik blocks? And again, we have a sufficient condition, namely that the characteristic pronomials of small g and small h are both excellent. This is again a complicated combinatorial condition, quite beautiful, which is too complicated to present it now. It's a precise condition which we can deal well with. And here we do not expect it's necessary, but we know it's sufficient, and that's what we will use later. So we will consider Tom Sebastiani sums of singularities and then prove with this result that if two singularities allow standard satisfy Orlik's conjecture, then also the sum satisfies Orlik's conjecture. Now I recall some known things about isolated quasi-homogeneous hypersurface singularities. First, in this talk, a weight system means the m-tuple of rational numbers between 0 and 1. And given such a weight system, a polynomial in m variables x1 to xm is called quasi-homogeneous if all the monomials which have non-zero coefficients have weighted degree 1. And finally, such a quasi-homogeneous polynomial is called an isolated quasi-homogeneous singularity if the first derivatives vanish simultaneously only at 0 in Cm. So that means that the hypersurface over 0 is smooth outside 0 and has an isolated singularity at 0. So, and there's an old theorem of Kushnirenko which characterizes combinatorially precisely all those weight systems W for which isolated singularities exist. Isolated quasi-homogeneous singularities exist. So roughly, we need enough monomials, but the theorem of Kushnirenko gives a precise condition. So here come two important families of examples. The polynomial in part A, which you see, is quasi-homogeneous and has an isolated singularity, and is called a chain-type singularity. Chain-type because the monomials form in a natural way a chain. And the second polynomial in part B, which you see, is also quasi-homogeneous and also has an isolated singularity, and is called a cycle-type singularity because the monomials form in a natural way a cycle. So Milner in his famous book from 1668 considered isolated hypersurface singularities, and here we care only about the quasi-homogeneous case. And for that case, his results imply the following. Let's start with an isolated quasi-homogeneous singularity with some weight system W. Then the middle homology, the middle reduced homology of the fiber over 1, which is a smooth fiber, is a z-lattice of a finite rank. This rank is the Milner number mu, and this lattice is called the Milner lattice. Also, there is a natural automorphism, the monomy, which is has finite order in the quasi-homogeneous case. So here we have a pair of a z-lattice, big H Milner, and an automorphism, small h Milner, the integral monomy on this lattice. And shortly afterwards, Milner and Orlik gave a formula for the characteristic pronomial of this monomy in terms of the weight system. So that means that we can control well the eigenvalues and their multiplicities, and thus also the Yordle normal form of this semi-simple automorphism. But they could not control the integral monomy. This is a much harder problem than just the Yordle normal form. But Orlik conjectured a few years later that in this situation of a quasi-homogeneous singularity, this pair of Milner lattice and monomy allows a standard decomposition into Orlik blocks. So he conjectured that this pair takes the simplest possible shape. And before I come to our results on this pair, I will have still to recall some other classical result. Also in the early 70s, Sebastiani and Tom considered sums of singularities, quasi-homogeneous or not, also sums of polynomials in different variables, which have all isolated singularities. Then the sum has also isolated singularities, and they prove that the Milner lattice with monomy of the pair is canonically isomorphic to the tensor product of the Milner lattices with monomies of the two single singularities. So, and this sum is nowadays called Tom-Sebastiani sum. So, and one can usually iterate this construction, and especially if we start with the chain type singularities and cycle type singularities and iterate this construction of Tom-Sebastiani sums, we obtain a subclass of all isolated quasi-homogeneous singularities, which is quite important. The subclass consists of the so-called invertible polynomials, and they are important nowadays in mirror symmetry. So now I come to our results, which is the main result of the second paper, but it builds also on the first paper on the archive. So part A. Part A is a relative result. If two isolated quasi-homogeneous singularities, F and G, satisfy all its conjecture, then also the Tom-Sebastiani sum satisfies all its conjecture. Part B, the chain-type singularities satisfy all its conjecture. Part C, the cycle-type singularities satisfy all its conjecture. Part D, all iterated Tom-Sebastiani sums of chain-type singularities and cycle-type singularities, so all invertible polynomials, satisfy all its conjecture. Of course, D is an immediate consequence of A, B, and C. And part C on the cycle-type singularities is proved in our first paper, our topological paper, which builds on a paper of Cooper from 1982 and which corrects this paper. So there we have to control well a spectral sequence which was proposed by Cooper. Cooper's paper contains two serious mistakes, and one of them would imply that all this conjecture would be wrong. Then one would for even number of variables have a standard decomposition into Ohlig blocks, but not a standard decomposition into Ohlig blocks. But fortunately, there were these mistakes, and we can correct them, and all this conjecture is true. So part B follows from theorem 4 and theorem 13, which you see here. This is the result of Ohlig and Randell from 77. They prove that in the case of a chain-type singularity, there exists an automorphism small h, which is a mth root of the monodromy. So there is an h such that the mth power of h is equal to the monodromy. And furthermore, such that minor lattice with this automorphism is one single Ohlig block. So and, fortunately, theorem 4 applies in this situation. The set big M of orders of eigenvalues of this new automorphism together with a natural number mu is SDIOB sufficient, which is easy to check. Therefore, theorem 4 applies, and theorem 4 tells us that the minor lattice with monodromy allows a standard decomposition into Ohlig blocks. And finally, for the part A, we can apply theorem 6, our abstract algebraic Tom-Sebastiani type result, because the characteristic polynomial of the monodromy of an isolated quasi-homogeneous singularity is always excellent. This is theorem 14, which is proved in the same paper. This is non-trivial. The proof uses, of course, the formula for the characteristic polynomial by Milner-Ohlig from 1970, but it uses also Kushni-Renko's result on the weight systems which allow isolated quasi-homogeneous singularities. So because of theorem 14, we can apply theorem 6, and this gives immediately this relative result. So finally, why should we care about Ohlig's conjecture? And hopefully there are many reasons. I can offer you two reasons. One is that I care about the automorphism group of the Milner lattice with the Seifert form, and that can be controlled much better if Ohlig's conjecture holds. And this is relevant for calculations on the Torelli conjecture for Briescon lattices, which I did many years ago and which I did for many years. And also part B, the Ohlig's conjecture tells a lot about the link of the quasi-homogeneous singularity. And some of these links give interesting examples of Sasakian structures. And therefore, people who care about these Sasakian structures, they care also about Ohlig's conjecture. So thank you very much for your attention.